Hi, everyone, and welcome back. This is Professor Hall, and today we are going to talk about six things to know before reading I Know Why the Caged Bird Sings. Now, if you haven't already, please make sure to go back and watch the first lecture, which is a summary and overview of the book. And everything that I'm going to talk about in here, I kind of touched on in that first lecture. Now we're just going to go into a little bit more depth. So, number one, the Black Arts Movement. The Black Arts Movement was an African-American-led art and literary movement, which was active during the 1960s and 70s. Many people who embraced the Black Power Movement were cultural nationalists who called for the creation of poetry, novels, visual arts, and theater to reflect pride in Black history and culture. So, this was in some ways connected to the Black Panthers, who were kind of on the opposite end of this. These were people specifically interested in art and literature. The Black Arts Movement was formally established in 1965 after the assassination of Malcolm X, when Amiri Baraka, who is pictured up here, he opened the Black Arts Repertory Theater in Harlem. The movement soon spread to Chicago, Illinois, Detroit, Michigan, and San Francisco, California. So, kind of like the Harlem Renaissance in the 1920s, this is in some ways connected to that and almost an extension of some of the things that those authors and artists were trying to accomplish. So a lot of this did start with the Harlem Writers Guild, but as I just said, then it spread to other parts of the country, and it was really integral in expanding upon the civil rights movement. So doing similar things to what was being done with civil rights and politics in the areas of art, literature, music. Some of the work was quite controversial. Journalist Hannah Foster said, "Many works put forth a Black hypermasculinity in response to historical humiliation and degradation of African American men, but usually at the expense of some Black female voices." So this is one of the reasons that I think this book in particular is important for this movement. This is Maya Angelou here with author James Baldwin. Angelou's work is part of the Black Arts Movement, and after joining the Harlem Writers Guild, she was encouraged by Baldwin to write the story of her life. And as I mentioned in the previous video, she was quite active already in the civil rights movement, working with and for Martin Luther King Jr. and Malcolm X, and now is looking for a platform, right, for her voice. So you can kind of see why, if someone is a strong Black woman and she's seeing how women are being portrayed by some of the Black male artists, that she would kind of want to have her voice shine through and present women in a different way. So her books really did fight against the oppression of both African Americans and women. And unlike some of her counterparts, she achieved cultural recognition and economic success. Her works were really celebrated by mainstream culture. And many other writers and artists in this movement were as well. But I think, I don't know, would I say that she's the most well-known? Perhaps, because she's taught in school, in many schools, including this one. So the important thing is to know that this book is part, I think more than the other books that we've read for this class, this book really is trying to make a political statement. There are other books that we've read that the political statement might kind of be there, but it might not be as intentional as it is with I Know Why the Caged Bird Sings. Genre bending. So this is interesting. Initially, her book was labeled as autobiographical fiction. She recounts the events of her life, but it's not a dry nonfiction text. And before this point, a lot of autobiographies were trying to be like, you know, here is precisely what happened to me in 1932. Here is precisely what happened to me in 1934. For Angelou, as I mentioned when I did the summary, this is really not the case. What she's doing instead, she's really using literary elements. So theme, symbolism, setting, more typical of fictional works. And the richness of her descriptions and imagery, it's almost poetic in some places. So this is prose, which is writing that's not poetry, but it almost sounds like poetry because she's using these literary devices. For example, over this rocky area, relieved by a few shady tall persimmon trees, the graduating class walked. Well, that's beautiful. And I just picked a random sentence with some imagery in it. This is how she is writing throughout the entire book. So it's not fiction. Today, it might be categorized as creative nonfiction, but some people would call it an autobiography. And certainly she called the books autobiographies herself. But I really think that today, because of how we classify books, it's a better example of a memoir, which has become more popular in recent years. So I'm going to zoom in here for a second. Here are the differences. Memoirs cover part of an author's life. Autobiographies typically cover the entire life. Memoirs can be from anyone, not necessarily a person who's famous. Now, certainly Maya Angelou is famous, but she was not writing after she was famous, right? So an autobiography, for example, of a rock star, somebody that people already know, or a president. Autobiographies are usually written in chronological order from birth until the present day. Memoirs can be written chronologically, but often move back and forth in time. And that is exactly what we have in this book. Autobiography, greater emphasis on facts and history. Memoir, greater emphasis on emotional experience and interiority. And I think, to me, this is the key to this novel. I just called it a novel. It's not. Sorry. That is the key to this book. We are not looking at just the plain facts of history as they happened in chronological order. The author is really interested in placing emphasis on the emotional experience and how these things made her feel. We also have an unusual structure to memory. Before I look at my points, what I want to say here is, you know, if you think back to a time that you were in great pain, if I say that, three or four things might come up in your head. You might think about a breakup. You might think about a time when you had an injury, you broke your arm, or you hurt your back, or you fell and broke your leg. You might think of a time when you were extremely ill. You might think of a time when your parents were getting divorced and that caused you, again, emotional pain. And maybe you are listening to me talk and you're like, oh, well, yeah, I hurt my back like a year ago, but my parents got divorced when I was 17, or I broke my arm when I was 4, or whatever the case may be, right? Memories come up like that. We smell something and we remember something that's connected to that smell. We hear a song and we remember where we were the first time we heard it. So the book, in that sense, to me, makes total sense when you think about it in that way. A lot of authors today, and we'll talk about this more when we get into educated, just to sort of see the comparison. A lot of authors today who write memoirs sort of use the elements of fiction to shape their stories, not so much poetic elements, but a plot structure. You have an exposition, rising action, a climax, falling action, and a denouement, the ending, right? The kind of wrapping everything up. And some critics believe that this book has a three-act plot structure. I don't know about that. I think that Angelou is not really concerned as much with plot as she is with the plot of each episode. So this is told very episodically. It does not necessarily, and I mentioned this in my first lecture, have a traditional plot structure. This is what a three-act plot would look like. Act one is exposition and an inciting incident to bring you into the rest of the story. Again, rising action, a climax. So instead of coming right in the middle, like stories from Shakespeare, a lot is written like this. Act one, act two, act three, act four, act five. A three-act plot structure is a little bit different. And I don't know. I don't know that I see that. If you do, let me know. But at any rate, one memory emerges and merges into the next, and they are really connected by theme. There are, I think, really, if you were going to have a climax or turning point of the book, it really happens in about chapter 11 to 12, which means that on our graph here in a 36-chapter book, it'd be in this first third. The other way that the book is structured really are through the four settings. Stamps, Arkansas, followed by St. Louis, and then Stamps again, and then then San Francisco. But we're going to talk about setting a little bit later in one of the other lectures. For now, what I'd like you to do is listen as the author discusses how her memory works. Okay, so just to give you some context, this video is from 1984, and this is the first time that Angelou's books have been printed in Britain. So we're going to see here the host asking her why this is the first time her books have been printed in Britain, and then Maya Angelou begins to discuss how her memory works and how that has shaped some of her work. So we're just going to watch the first few minutes here.
Tell me, you've been a really big writer in the States. You've told me, to my shock and horror, that you've had 9 books out, whereas I'm only just beginning your, you've just started your first. Yes. You've been published along everywhere in Europe.
Yes. Why? And Africa and Asia.
Why not Britain until now?
I don't know. Safe to say that no publishers were as astute, profound, clear, intelligent, and bold as Virago Press.
Yes.
I have no idea. I'm the most read black female writer in the world. My books sell in the millions. And I have no idea why. I think some publishers suggested that people wouldn't be very interested in the exploits and the daring do of a black American girl. However, the truth is I write through the black experience. That's what I know. I'm talking always about the human condition, what it is like to be a human being, what makes us weep, what makes us laugh, what does us down. How sometimes our soul can look back and wonder how we got over. So I hope that when people read my work, and obviously this is so, since there are more whites in the United States than blacks, obviously, my books are read in universities, mostly required reading in most universities, I hope that I have told the truth about the human condition. Not just the facts, because facts oftentimes obscure the truth. So if I tell the truth, then an Asian man in Hong Kong, who still is so tradition-bound that he wears a plaid, can read it and say, that's the truth.
You see, in fact, I wasn't going to mention black. when I refer to your book, I know one would have to pretty soon because you were born.
Well, I'm 6 foot tall and I've been black a long time.
Not from the obvious quality of that, but from the fact that when I was reading your book, when I related to it,
yes,
it was relating to a person, a
right.
girl.
Yes.
Now, the thing about it is, though, that you do go back, you have almost a total recall, it would appear.
It would appear. I do seem to have total recall or none at all.
Mm. Ah.
I mean, and there is no rhyme nor reason to it. That is, I can, those things I remember everything about them.
Mm.
The sound, the background sounds, the feel in the air, the odors around, the color, everything. It's a strange kind of madness. But it's not because I remember the good things and forget the bad happily. Now, I remember the bad. I mean, there is no rhyme. I can remember the good things and the bad. Then I forget millions of excellent things that I'm reminded, of which I'm reminded, and forget bad things as well.
So I just wanted to get out of here for a second. There we go. If you couldn't hear that too well, I'm going to give you guys the link both in the description of the video and in your actual class in case you want to watch the whole thing. But basically what she said is, I have either total recall or none at all. So you see her there really talking about how her memory works, which then in turn drives the structure of the books that she writes. I think it's also interesting the point where, and I paused it because I was going to comment, but then I wanted to keep going. The point where she says, you know, I am trying to write the truth, not just facts. So facts are not always the truth. The emotional truth, the psychological, the spiritual truth that is there, that's what she's trying to communicate. So those are really important things to know before you read. That for her, the truth of each episode that she is describing and the episodes that she's choosing are the things that she remembers, the colors, the smells, the sounds, how she felt, how other people felt, how they looked, you know, all of those types of details. I also think that it's important to comment here, and this has nothing to do with the structure of this book, that in 1984, we have a little bit of a different understanding of race and diversity. So the very well-meaning moderator here, the interviewer, who says, well, I didn't even think about race when I read this book. It's you can't not think about race when you read this book, because that is one of the primary themes of the book. Racism and the African-American experience, particularly Angelou's experience as an African-American woman. But what I think that the moderator was trying to say was, I agree with you in that everyone can relate to some part of your narrative. And she was trying to say, yes, you are telling the truth. You are talking about things that in some sense are universal, of rejection, of trauma, of being a woman, those types of things. So to give her some credit, even though I think it was kind of a insensitive is not the right word, and dumb isn't either, but it's somewhere on that line of that particular comment. But the rest of it is a great interview, and I highly recommend watching the whole thing. So different places and different lives. This is a picture of a general store in Arkansas. I couldn't find one of the actual store, if it even still is there, in Stamps. But Stamps, Arkansas, low and slow. A slow way of life, a rural agricultural existence. You have the store, the cotton pickers. There's not a whole lot, you know, kind of going on in many instances. There's it's not the fast, quick, exciting life of a city. So you can kind of see, you know, an existence like this versus this is St. Louis in about 1940 at a train station. And then there's the streetcar in San Francisco around the same time. This would be around maybe 42, 43. And quite a different quite a different type of life. What I really want you to notice, first, as we talked about already, the structure. So how is it structured between these three places, stamps and then St. Louis, going back to stamps and then going to San Francisco? But also, how does Maya try to change or fit in to each of these places? This is called displacement. She's moved around from one place to another, often not really by her own free will, because she's a child and then a younger teenager, right? So how does she feel about these places? The memory that she was just talking about, what memories are connected to these places, what feelings are connected to them, and how are they tied into characterization? What are the people like who live in St. Louis? Her mother and her uncles and her mother's friends. What are the people like in San Francisco? What is life like there for her? How does her relationship with her mother begin to change when she's in San Francisco because of this different setting? And then in stamps, you know, again, what is life like there? How does she feel about it? Those types of things. So the flight from Arkansas, here are some cotton pickers in Arkansas. You can see the clothes that some of them are wearing there. In the 1920s, in addition to Jim Crow laws mandating separate educational institutions, so those are the laws of segregation, Arkansas had 7 laws requiring the physical segregation of the races. Now, in some places, because of the small population of African Americans, it looked slightly different in Arkansas than other southern states. I don't know if that is reflected in this book. But in some places of Arkansas, the relationships between people who were white and people who were African-American was not as strictly segregated, supposedly, as places like Alabama or Georgia. However, the relationships really varied by class and location. During the Great Depression, African Americans really did suffer more than their white counterparts. So, for example, in Little Rock, they made up 20% of the population, but 54% of the unemployed. So when things were tough across the country, especially because of the racism, the discrimination, the segregation, and Jim Crow laws, people who were African Americans suffered even more than some of the other populations. This is a picture from that period of time. This is the 1930s. This is the unemployment line, or possibly the bread line, people lining up to get food. And behind them, a white family. There's no way like the American way, the world's highest standard of living. So quite a disconnect, right, between what life looks like with the American dream and what it actually was. All of this is going on in the background. Discrimination and New Deal programs worsened circumstances for African Americans in Arkansas in particular. For example, Social Security was not extended to people who did housework, such as maids and cooks or farm workers. So a lot of the people who had those jobs were African American, and they were not getting any money for Social Security for their later years. From 1890 to 1940, white residents forced African Americans to make a great retreat from Arkansas and leave to the north. Lynchings peaked during this time, as did other hate crimes. And this is the time that we are looking at. So the two incidents with men who are hiding from the KKK or from the law to avoid being lynched, that was a real threat at the time. In 1960, Six Arkansas counties had no African Americans, and many more counties still contained at least one sundown town. So a sundown town were named that because they were forced, they forbid blacks from living there. They marked their city limits with signs saying, "Don't let the sun go down on you here." Essentially what this meant was you could come in and work as a farmhand, as a cook, as a maid, you know, in those types of jobs doing menial labor, but you are not allowed to actually live in those towns. And in the 19, there we go. This is a book by James Lowen about sundown towns specifically. This is The Sign, Whites Only Within City Limits After Dark. Hidden Dimension of American Racism. In 1940s, as the United States entered World War II, black citizens were increasingly unwilling to accept second-class citizenship because many of them were serving in the military. So African-American soldiers were challenging racial discrimination and segregation, but many white soldiers reacted negatively and began to enforce Jim Crow laws even more aggressively, which leads then into the 1950s, where you have things like Brown versus the Board of Education, and other things leading up to the civil rights movement. But so basically what I want to say is, sorry to skip ahead there, a couple things. I say this about 1960 because it was all of this time period leading up to 1960, right? The sundown towns were going on at the time of the incidents in this book. And this is almost always in the background of nearly every chapter, but particularly in Stamps, there are things that happen that I think are more overt than in St. Louis or in San Francisco, although the racism there is almost a different flavor because it's really more against Asian Americans. But the Great Retreat from Arkansas is, I think, sort of what happens when the family leaves for California. Their grandmother is trying to get them away from these things that are happening, and she knows that if they go to California, it's not that they won't still face racism, because especially at this point they will, but it won't be possibly as dangerous for them. And unfortunately, this is still a battle in Arkansas, which is going on today. So anti-racist is a code word for anti-white. Welcome to Harrison, beautiful town, beautiful people, no wrong exits, no bad neighborhoods. This is a town that was a sundown town, and this is the sign that they have now. Now, somebody, vandalized the sign. Anti-racist is a code word for love. And I love that they did that. But they're still kind of going on in some ways. And there are people who are resisting and fighting back. In other areas, this is from Georgia, segregated prom and ongoing controversy. Now, that was in 2018. Just at the time I'm recording this, just a couple of years ago, a school in Georgia had a segregated prom. When they integrated the school, they kept the prom segregated. So they had one prom for whites and one prom for people of color. And they, when the students a couple years ago wanted to have an integrated prom, the school said, "Well, if you want to do that, then we're not going to have a prom at all." And the students themselves ended up having a private prom that they invited everybody to. And now I believe that they have finally integrated it, but I'm not entirely sure. But my point is, I don't want you to read, and I don't think many of you will, but just in case you do, I don't want you to read this book and say, "Well, that's stuff that happened in the 1930s and it doesn't apply today." Because there are things in this book that are very, very relevant to the world in which we still live. including number six. So this is our next thing to know, the history of sexual assault. So again, a trigger warning, if you, I probably should have given it before talking about racism, but if you have a sensitivity or you've had experience in this, you can end the show now if you need to, or the lecture. So early in American history, rape was defined as intercourse by force and against the woman's will. Stephanie Roger explains that this focused on the responsive, sorry, I put that in wrong, the response of the victim, and led to the interpretation that rape was, it was only rape if the woman demonstrated, quote, the utmost resistance during the entire rape. So the woman would have to say, I resist at this point, and then this point, and then this point, and then this point. Women of color endured even more dire conditions. During the 1800s, most states excluded black women, both free and enslaved, from rape laws. The book Incidents in the Life of a Slave Girl by Harriet Jacobs. This is an autobiography, a slave narrative, and Harriet Jacobs basically is being sexually harassed by her owner in order to escape from him, to not be raped. She hides for several years and then eventually makes her way to freedom by escaping. But this was not uncommon, and it really makes me angry when people talk about is it Thomas Jefferson and Sally Hemings, when they say, like, oh, they had a relationship. That's not what was going on. They did not have a relationship, especially when she would not have had any rights to her body, let alone to her body in terms of sex. So slave women frequently endured violent sexual abuse, often resulting in pregnancy. You can read about this from a male's perspective in Frederick Douglass's various autobiographies. If a slave woman attempted to defend herself against such abuse, she could be beaten severely, possibly even killed. And at that point, again, because they were their owner's property, murdering people was not hard to get away with. This is a picture of the first wave of feminism, women asking for the vote. So in the late 1800s and early 1900s, suffragettes who were working for the right for women to vote, they also tried to enact various social changes. So they were involved not only in the right to vote, but also in prohibition, and also child labor laws. And in addition to those things, they worked to change the age of consent from 10 up to 18. And in various states, 32 at the time, raised the age to 14, 15, 16, all the way up to 18. Some southern states lagged behind, seeming to fear in part because legislatures, and this is a quote, feared that it would, quote, enable Negro girls to sue white men, and thus, quote, put Negro female on the same plane as the white female. So there was a racial aspect to them refusing to raise the age of consent. So therefore, a man could have a sexual encounter, molestation or rape of a 10-year-old, and they could say that that was consensual, as if a 10-year-old could consent. In 1895, one Kentucky legislator wrote, I regard the 12-year-old girl as being capable of resisting the wiles of the seducer as any older woman. So again, saying that children are able to make the same decisions as adults, or to be able to resist in the same way. So this is a picture from later, Take Back Our Bodies, during the women's rights movement. The anti-rape movement really emerged as part of women's rights in the 1960s, so kind of building upon what had been done by the suffragettes up to the 1920s. It was not really until 1973 that child sexual abuse was specifically recognized as a type of child maltreatment. Now, that does not mean that it wasn't illegal. It just means that there were specific laws against that, very specifically enacted by Congress in 1973. In 1975, Congress rape shield laws limit the defendant's ability to probe into the sexual behavior, history, or reputation of an alleged victim. Now, that still went on after that. If you ever watch the movie The Accused, which is based on a true story, you can see that happening, that they ask her, how much did you have to drink? Were you being flirtatious? Were you being provocative, right? How many people had you slept with before? All of those types of things. But that's really what that was meant to prevent. And in the book, this does come up. They ask Maya, had he done this to you before? Had he touched you before? And she really doesn't even know how to answer, because at the age of 8, we don't have a good understanding of sexuality or sex. And she doesn't really fully get what has happened to her prior to the incident of being raped. She really doesn't even fully understand what's going on or why they're asking her those questions. Marital rape was not forbidden by all 50 states until 1993. Doesn't really have to do with the events of the book, but you can kind of see the understanding of sexual assault, of molestation. I wanted to play this video clip for you guys, but it turned out just to be too long. That was of a TV movie from the 1980s. It really just sort of shows how people thought about this back then. And really, Megan's Law required law enforcement to make information available to the public regarding sexual offenders. That was passed in 1996. But the way that people talked about this, in my grandmother's time, my grandmother was born, I'm trying to think now, she's almost 100. So she was born in 1922. There was a person that her family knew of who was a child molester. And what they would do was just say to her, oh, well, don't talk to him. Make sure that you don't talk to him. Stay away from that guy because he likes to try to show girls things. That's what they would say. And so when things happened, they did not always go through court. They did not always go to the police. They may be covered up. They may be ignored. They may be not talked about. So in some instances, in some ways in this book, it's unusual that, number one, that she told, number two, that she was believed, and number three, that the person who did these things to her went to court and was sentenced to any prison time at all, because all of this is happening before this anti-rape movement. And I believe very strongly that he likely would not have gotten any jail time had it not been for her age, because she was under the age of 10. If she had been 14, I don't think that you would have seen this go to court. But because really she was still viewed as a child, that is probably the reason that this happened. So I really want you guys to watch for that. The ways in which, in some instances, sex is not, the ways in which sex is talked about, we're going to talk about more later when we get into themes. But particularly the events that happen here. I mentioned my grandmother, you know, growing up in the 1930s around the same time, and how her family reacted to people who were hurting children in that way and assaulting them. By the time my mother was around that age, a very similar thing. There was a man who all the girls in the neighborhood babysat for. He tried to chase a girl around and tried to get them and make them kiss him. These girls were maybe 13, 14. And what happened? The girl's mother called everyone in the neighborhood and said, do not let your daughters babysit for this man. So again, no reporting. This is long before the Me Too movement. So I want you to kind of be aware of those cultural and historical differences. And in some sense, what was happening back then is still happening today. These are two white teens who raped a one-year-old black baby girl, streamed it live, posted pictures on a pornography website, and had no jail time. They were sentenced to time served and therapy programs. I'm sorry, it's the same. It's two pictures of the same boy. But he molested a child, took pictures of it, took video of it, put it online, and did not get jail time. So if you're mad about somebody in the 1930s getting only a year, this is where we're still living. This is an article about the incest loophole in New York State that was just in 2005. I believe since then it's been closed. But basically, if someone is a member of a child's family and molests them, they did not have to go to jail. They could go instead through treatment program. A loophole, this has not been closed yet, this loophole, in New York, sexual assault consent laws. If people are intoxicated in some states, according to state penal code, if they're not capable of giving consent, because of intoxication, then it prevents them from prosecuting that rape case. And this was set in 2012. It seems to me, from what I understand from doctors, that it's really rare. If it's a legitimate rape, the female body has ways to try to shut down the whole thing. But let's assume that that didn't work or something. I think there should be some sort of punishment. So this is a congressman talking, and the idea that legitimate rape... No, rape is rape, right? There's not legitimate rape and not legitimate rape. If it's not legitimate rape, it's consensual sex. So what he's saying is nobody should be able to get pregnant from rape because the female body will just shut that down. If it's real rape, the woman won't allow herself to be pregnant. So you have here instances and things that are really showing that are the understanding of sexual assault, what it is, how to prosecute it, is still evolving. And hopefully we will get there and protect the victims. So to connect this to the book, she was raped at the age of 8. Her rapist was found guilty. He spent one day in jail. He was released, I believe, to then go back into jail. I think the one day he spent was before the trial. When he was released, he was murdered. And it's not entirely clear who did this, but Maya really believed that she was at fault. And it was her voice and the fact that she told that killed him. She says, I killed that man because I told his name. And then I thought I would never speak again because my voice would kill anyone. But one of the other themes here is that of resilience and moving from being a victim to being a survivor. So I'm just gonna zoom in here. You may write me down in history with your bitter, twisted lies. You may tread me in the very dirt, but still, like dust, I'll rise. You may shoot me with your words. You may cut me with your eyes. You may kill me with your hatefulness, but still, like air, I'll rise. Out of the huts of history's shame, I rise. Up from the past that's rooted in pain, I rise. Bringing the gifts that my ancestors gave, I am the dream and the hope of the slave. I rise, I rise, I rise. That is a poem, not in the book, but definitely connected to it. And later, I just have this quote from an interview she did. Forgiveness, it's one of the greatest gifts you can give yourself, to forgive. Forgive everybody. You're relieved of carrying that burden of resentment. You are really lighter. You feel lighter. You just drop that. So there are in the book very dark, intense themes of racism, oppression, discrimination, sexual assault, sexism, sexuality, and family relationships. But there are also themes of resistance and resilience and hope. And that is where we're going to leave off today. Next time, we're going to look at some of those themes and talk about how they present in the memoir.